Hello everyone, so welcome back to our series on understanding calculus. Today we will continue our discussion on functions. First we will discuss rational function. Now what is a rational function? A rational function is a ratio of two polynomial functions. If fx and gx are two polynomials, you have studied what polynomials are, where gx cannot be 0, that is important because the denominator can never be 0. So fx is a polynomial, gx is a polynomial and gx is not 0. So these are the conditions to be fulfilled to call it a rational function. The simplest type of rational function that we will try to understand is a reciprocal function. So your 1 obviously is a constant, which is also a polynomial, and x you know is a polynomial. So the simplest type of rational function is the function y is equal to 1 upon x, and the graph of this goes this way. That means if this is your x axis, this is your y axis, then this is a type of graph that you get, and this you must have known is what is described as a rectangular hyperbola. This will pass through 0.11 over here and -1, -1 over here. So this is a rectangular hyperbola. So this is a rational function. Now here the domain is a set of entire real numbers. The range is also the set of entire real numbers except 0, because neither the domain includes 0, because this line goes towards the y-axis, this also goes towards the y-axis, but it does not touch y-axis at any point. Similarly, this goes towards x-axis, this goes towards x-axis, but it does not touch x-axis at any point. So y cannot be 0. So x can neither be 0 nor y can be 0. So the domain would include all real values except 0. The range would also include all real values except 0. Now this x-axis and y-axis are known as asymptotes. These asymptotes are the lines where this graph would tend to meet but would never meet. So these are what are known as asymptotes. So this is a rational function. Then we describe what is y is equal to 1 upon x square. And in our classification we had seen that the reciprocal function could have an even power or an odd power. So this is an even power. So it's raised to the power 2. Now since it is x square, it will come only on the positive side. The way we describe x square, x raised to the power 4, where the polynomial was there only in the numerator. Similarly, even if the polynomial is in the denominator, if it is an even power, it will be this way. So what was earlier this part of the graph has now come up, and now we have this line and this line. So this is a graph of y is equal to 1 upon x square. Here also the domain includes all the real values except 0, and the range is only positive values. It does not include negative values, but it also does not include 0, because the line does not touch 0. It seems to go towards the x-axis, but it does not ever touch the x-axis. So y also will never be 0. So the range will be only the positive real values. Any positive real value is included in the range. The domain is all real values except 0. Then we come to further types of reciprocal functions with odd power. That means something like 1 upon x, 1 upon x cube, 1 upon x 7, you can have 1 upon x 5 also, that's also fine. 1 upon x 9, all those things are odd powers. And you see these graphs, 1 upon x, 1 upon x 2, 1 upon x 7, and all of them will pass through 1, 1 and minus 1, minus 1. And here what I want you to see is that if x is more than 1, then obviously once you take the reciprocal, 1 upon x will be more than 1 upon x cube will be more than 1 upon x raised to the power 7. Hence, but if x is less than 1, it will be the other way around. That means 1 upon x 7 will be more than 1 upon x cube, which will be more than 1 upon x. And similarly on the negative side. If it is an even power, if we have say 1 upon x square, 1 upon x raised to the power 4, 1 upon x raised to the power 6. Here it will pass through 1, 1 and minus 1, 1. In the above case, it was minus 1, minus 1. Here it is minus 1, 1. Because once you take the even power, this output will become positive. And here, this is 1 upon x. This is 1 upon x raised to the power 4, 1 upon x raised to the power 6. So if it is more than x is more than 1, 1 upon x square will be more than 1 upon x raised to the power 4 will be more than 1 upon x to the power 6. And it would be the other way around if x is less than 1. And similarly on the negative side. Then we talked of irrational function, which also is described as a radical function. So here it is something like your square root sign. So the square root function is root of x, and which will always be positive. So this red graph is a graph of square root x, whereas the cube root function is represented by the blue graph, which goes on the positive side as well as on the negative side. Cube root, you can have its negative values, because cube root of say minus 8 would be minus 2, but square root of minus x is not allowed, and hence the square root function will only be on the positive side, whereas the cube root function will be on the positive side as well as the negative side. Then we consider the piecewise function. Now, piecewise function is an extremely important function that you must study well, because it is a favorite of the examiners, and most of your exams would have some questions on this piecewise functions in some way or the other. So the simplest piecewise function is a signum function. Now, signum means basically it will just give you the sign of the x value. Now, if x is more than or equal to 0, then the value would be 1. Sorry, this is not equal to, this is x is more than equal to 0. If x is equal to 0, this is, so there should be a correction over here. If x is more than 0, then the output would be 1. If x is equal to 0, then the output would be 0. And here also, this is not there. So it will be x less than 0. Then it will be minus 1. So if x is more than 0, the output will be 1. If x is 0, the output will be 0. And if x is less than 0, the output will be minus 1. So this will be, this entire thing will have an output 1. So it is appears like a constant function, but only when x is more than 1. And here this value is not included. I made this correction over here. So if x is equal to 0, then this value is not included. This big dot will be the value, or will be the output. And if it is less than 0, then the output would be minus 1. So this is a signum function. Here the domain. Domain would be the entire set of real values. And the range. Range will be only 3 values. See, if x is positive, it will be 1. If x is 0, it will be 0. And if x is any negative value, then the output will be minus 1. So the range will be just 3 specific values, minus 1, 0 and 1. So these are, this is not an interval, these are specific values, and hence written with curly brackets. It will be minus 1, 0 and minus 1. Then we come to the modulus function. Now this also is very important. And modulus function is written this way. So y is equal to, and this is the type of brackets that you put. That means they are basically straight lines. They are not brackets, but straight lines. And this is the modulus of x. This is the way it is represented. Now this means that it will, the output will be just a positive value of x. That means if x is more than or equal to 0, more than or equal to 0, then the output would be just x. And if x is less than 0, then it will become minus x. So if x was already more than 0, if x was less than 0, so it's a negative value, and if you take the minus of x, it will become positive. So for example, suppose if x is 5, then the output would be just 5. If x is 4, the output will be 4. If x is 0, then 2, the output would be 0. But if x is minus 5, so you have to again take minus. See, it is minus x. So if x is minus 5, then you take minus of minus 5, which will become 5. So eventually it will yield a positive value. So this function, the giraffe would be this way. So, and this is a giraffe of y is equal to x. So that means it's like an identity function. So whatever the value you put in, the same output you get. Whereas here, it is a giraffe of y is equal to minus x. So here the sign changes. So if x is say minus 3, then minus of minus 3 will be 3. So y will become 3. So this is a graph that you must remember, inclusive of this point 0, 0. So this is a modulus function. Then we thought of greatest integer function. Now, just a thing that you must remember in the previous in the domain. If suppose the domain of root of x minus 7 is asked, then what is the output? Now, see, we had seen that if any value is there under the root sign, that means you can take only the positive value. Now, x minus 7, suppose if this modulus sign was not there, then we have seen that this means x minus 7 should be more than or equal to 0. So, x has to be more than or equal to 7. But if this modulus sign is also there, now modulus sign will always make it positive. So even if say x is say minus, say x is 5, then the x minus 7 will be minus 2. Now if the modulus sign is not there, then minus 2 would not have been allowed. But since the modulus sign is there, then minus 2 will get converted to plus 2. And so then that will be allowed. So all positive, all values of x more than 7 will obviously be allowed, because then x will be more than 7 and x minus 7 will be a positive number. But all values less than 7 will also be allowed, because if x is 6 or 5 or 4 or 0 or even some negative value, so that minus 7 would yield a negative value, but the modulus sign will make it positive, and hence the function will be defined. Except if x is exactly equal to 7, then x minus 7 would be 0 and the modulus of 0 will be 0, and 0 is also allowed. So here the domain would be the entire set of real values. So your domain would be R. Whereas if you have something like this, lot of modulus of x minus 7 to the base a, a is a constant. Now here we had seen that x minus 7 has to be more than 0. So if x is more than 7, for example x is 8, 9, 10, it will be a positive value. So that is fine, and the modulus of that will also be positive, so there is no issue. If x is less than 7, then to everything is fine, because suppose if x is 6 or 5 or 0 or any negative value, it will yield a negative value. But once you take the modulus, it will become positive. So that will be fine and the function will be defined. But if x is exactly equal to 7, then what will happen? That this 7 minus 7 will become 0. Modulus of 0 will be 0. So this will become log of 0, and log of 0 is not defined, because the log of a number has the number has to be either more than has to be more than 0. It cannot be equal to 0 also. So this will be all the real values except 7. So this will be the domain. Then we come to the greatest integer function, or what is described as a step function. Now this can also be described as a step function, and some people also call it as a floor function. Floor function. Now we'll see what this is. Now suppose if you have this value, then if it is an integer, suppose you have a value say 3, then the greatest integer less than or equal to 3, equal to is allowed. So greatest integer, all the integers less than 3 are say any negative integer or 0 or even 1 or even 2. Even 3 is allowed, because it is greatest integer less than or equal to x. So if you say greatest integer less than or equal to x, all integers up to 3, including 3, are allowed, but it has to be a full integer. So suppose if you say greatest, and this is a type of bracket that you use, that means your square brackets, and this will remind you of your close intervals. The bracket is almost appears similar to your close brackets, but the context is different. So you must see what the context is also. This represents Dirichlet's integer, and obviously in closed interval you will have two values. Here you will have only one value or one expression. So either it will be a single value or a single expression. There won't be some comma and another expression. So this is the Dirichlet's integer function. So if it is Dirichlet's integer of less than or equal to 3, then the answer would be 3. Because of all the integers less than or equal to 3, 0, 1, 2, 3, 3 is the Dirichlet's. 4 will not be allowed because that is more greater than 3, that is not less than 3. So 4 would not be allowed. So the Dirichlet's integer less than or equal to 3 would be 3. Now suppose if you have 3.5, then the Dirichlet's integer less than or equal to 3.5 would also be 3, because all again 0, 1, 2, 3, everything would be allowed, and 4 would not be allowed. And obviously decimals and fractions would not be allowed, because here we are talking of the Dirichlet's integer. So you can get only integers as output. So of the integers 0, 1, 2, 3 are allowed, 4 is not allowed. So of 0, 1, 2, 3 and all the negative integers, 3 is the Dirichlet's. And so the Dirichlet's integer less than or equal to 3.5 would be 3. Again, if it is 4, then it will be 4. If it is 4.1, it will be 4. So that's all easy to understand. Now, if it is 0, then 0 also is an integer. So again, it will behave the same way. So you can write the Dirichlet's integer less than or equal to 0 is also 0. Now, suppose if you have some negative value, then what happens? Suppose the negative, so if you have say minus 3, then minus 3 is an integer, and any integer less than or equal to minus 3 would be something like minus 3 inclusive, then minus 4, minus 5, minus 6, minus 7, of which the greatest is minus 3. You must remember that minus 4 is less than minus 3, minus 5 is even further less than minus 3, so they are all less, and whereas minus 2, minus 1 is greater than minus 3. So minus 3 would be the greatest of them, so that would be fine. But if it is say minus 3.1, so this is very, very important. This you must understand well. Now suppose if it is minus 3.1, then the integers less than minus 3.1 would be minus 4. See, suppose if you have your number line over here, and this is your 0, and this is your 1, 2, 3, 4. This is your minus 1, minus 2, minus 3, and minus 4. See, now where does minus 3.1 lie? So if this is 0, then this is minus 1, minus 2, and see, this is minus 3. So your minus 3.1 will lie somewhere over here. And you have to take integer less than this. So less than this would be minus 4. If you take 3, it is greater than minus 3.1. So on the negative side, you have to be a little extra careful. So if it is minus 3.1 or minus 3.2 or minus 3.3, anything, then it will become minus 4. If it is an integral value, like say minus 3, then minus 3 is fine because equal to is allowed. But if it is minus 3.1, then minus 3 is not equal, it is greater than minus 3.1. So minus 4 would be your answer. So on the negative side, you will have to be careful. So similarly, if there is a minus 5.2, then the Dirichlet's integer would be minus 6. And for a this is a special example that you must remember. Pi, what is the Dirichlet's integer of pi? Now pi, as you very well know, is 3.14 and something further. So the Dirichlet's integer will be 3. Alright, and then we see what is the graph of this Dirichlet's integer. Now see, this is a graph, so that is why it is known as a step function. So these appear like steps. So for all values, for all x inputs between 0 and 1, this is 1, this is 2, so this is 1. So for all values between 0 and 1, whenever x is between 0 and 1, the output will be 0. Once it is 1, if x is 1, then y also will be 1. So this will be the point. Then if x is anywhere between 1 and 2, the y will be again 1. If x is equal to 2, then y will be 2. Then if it is 2.1, 2.5, 2.6, 2.7, output will be 2. If it is 3, then it will come here. So these are what are known as steps. And you must always remember that this point is included in the graph, this point is excluded. Because once it touches 2, then this becomes output. Once this touches 3, then this becomes the output. Similarly, on the negative side, see, for example, if this is 0, then this is minus 0.1, 0.2, 0.3, 0.4, then the output will be minus 1, as we studied a little earlier. If it is, say, minus 1.1, minus 1.2, minus 1.3, the output will be minus 2. So this would be your output, and this way. So this is included, this is not included. So this you must understand very well. So this is a greatest integer function. There are some properties of greatest integer function which you should also remember. One is, if the greatest integer function, for example, if the greatest integer function of x is equal to x, then x has to be an integer. As we have seen a little earlier, greatest integer of 3 is 3. So the other way around also, if the greatest integer of x is the same as x, that means you have not changed anything. So obviously there is nothing beyond 3, that means no decimal points or no fractions. So if x is an integer, the greatest integer function would remain as x. And if the greatest integer is the same as the function, then x has to be an integer. Then suppose if you have x, say greatest integer of x and greatest integer of minus x. This is very interesting. For example, you have say 3, and then so greatest integer of 3 and plus greatest integer of minus 3. Now, since this is an integer, then your output would be 3, your output would be minus 3, and so the sum would be 0. So this is, if this is a, these are integers. But suppose if you have 3.1 and plus minus 3.1. Now your, the greatest integer would be 3, and your, it will be minus 4. See, be careful, because on the negative side you will have 1 less. So 3 plus minus 4 will always be minus 1. And suppose if it is, say, minus 6.4, so here the greatest integer would be 6, and here it would be minus 7. So again you will have minus 1. So this is what I was trying to make you understand, that if here there is an error, if x is an integer, if x is an integer, x belongs to I, then x plus gif of x and gif of minus x will be 0. Whereas if x is not an integer, if x is not an integer, so x is not an integer, then it will be minus 1. Another thing that you must remember is x plus m, greatest integer, if m is an integer, if m is an integer, then m can just go out of the bracket. For example, suppose you have a function, say, where x is 3, say 3.1, then it's easier to understand, and plus another integer 5, then see, because this does not have any fractional or a decimal value, so this will become 8.1 and the answer would be 8. But similarly, if you were to take this 5 outside, then to this would be 3 and this would be 5. So this is, this once it goes out, it does not make any difference, because the decimal and the fraction would remain within the GIF sign, and hence it will be taken care of. And since this has got no additional decimal point or fraction, it can go out. So here also you will get 8, here also you will get 8. Similarly, if you have say 2.1 plus say 10, so this will become 12.1 and the GIF will be 12. And if you, and if you take say 2, here also it will be 2 plus 10, so it will be 12. So this can go out of the same. And but suppose if you have a non-integral value, see, if m is an integer, it can go out. But here if you have something like say y, and if y is also an integer, then it won't make any difference. If x and y both are integers, then obviously the decimal or the fraction won't be there, so there won't be any adjustments. So it will remain as x plus y. But if they have some adjustments, for example, H is say 3.1 and Y is equal to say 5.3, then it will become 8.4. Now, since this 0.3 and 0.3, 0.1 and 0.3 have to get adjusted, so these are the those adjustment values. So these are, this will study little later on, this Turley bracket stands for the fractional part. So that was 0.1 and 0.3. So as long as it is less than 1, it will be taken care of and it will become again 3 and 5. For example, you have 3.1 plus 5.3, then the total will be 8.4, and so the GIF will be 8. And if you even take them out separately, 3.1 and 5.3, so then this will yield 3, this will this will be 3, this will be 5, and the total will still be 8. So this is because this 0.1 and 0.3 have got not made much of a difference, as long as the total is less than 1. But if the total is between 1 and 2, that means inclusive of 1 and less than 2, this was less than 1, this is inclusive of 1. For example, if it was say 3.5 plus 5.6, right? So here what will happen is it will become 9.1. So then here you will get 9, and if you take them separately, you will get 3 and 5, 8. So because this 5 and 6 also added up to more than 1, so it has given you 1 more than this value. So in that case, it will be this plus this plus 1. So that is if the fractional parts add up to anywhere between 1 and 2, that means inclusive of 1 but less than 2. It will obviously be less than 2 if there are two things, because the fractional part cannot be equal to 2. Then we talk about the least integer function. The least integer function is not any big deal, and it is something similar to your greatest integer function, but it's on the other side. So we won't discuss that in much detail. But for example, if and this is written either as close brackets, or some people also write it as this way. So there won't be lines over here, now as over here. So suppose if you say the least integer function, if it is an integer, it remains as integer. For example, if it is 3, it will remain as 3. But if it is a 3.1, then it is least integer greater than 3.1. So then the least integer greater than 3.1 would be 4. Whereas on the negative side, if you have say, so here, since it is greater than this, will yield minus 3. So here this is the way it goes. So on the positive side, it will add one value, and on the negative side, this 0.1 will disappear and it will remain minus 3. So with this, we end today's session, and we'll continue with this next time. If you like the video, then press the subscribe button and press the bell icon to receive notification. Press the like button and share it with your friends. Thank you so much.